thank you very, very much to everybody for coming and for the Brooklyn Public Library for hosting this event. A personal thank you also to Suyun Locks, my friend from Philadelphia, who made the precious introduction to Linda that set this whole ball rolling. Mm-hmm. Wonderful. The review panel. Who is here at a review panel for the first time? That's impressive. That looks like a healthy, hearty plurality of this audience. So let me, for your benefit and to refresh the memories of those who are seasoned review panelists and review panel attendees, run through exactly what we're doing. As all of you hopefully know, we have been, those of us who are paid to be here certainly have been, and many of you, the audience, have been to see four current exhibitions of contemporary art around New York City. Two, unusually, at one venue, Canada Gallery on the Lower East Side, and the other two at Pioneer Works in Red Hook and Luring Augustine Bushwick in Bushwick. So, what we do, the format of the evening, is simplicity itself. We have prepared short PowerPoint presentations. We'll look at the PowerPoints for the first two shows that we're going to discuss, which this evening happen to be the Brooklyn shows, Glenn Ligon in Bushwick and Charles Harlan in Red Hook. Then my guests, who I'm about to introduce, and I thrash it out, decide what we make of this, reach consensus or agree to differ on those two shows dealt with consecutively. Then it's a chance for you, the people, to have your say in this this town hall of aesthetic criticism. And as I'll explain again at that time, in contrast to 99 out of 100 moderators, I actually prefer comments to questions, because questions usually require an answer and that takes much too long. So comments, much more welcome. Just let off some steam, tell us what you think, and we'll have a review panel, not of four critics, but of 220 critics. And then we'll repeat the exercise for part two, for the two shows at Canada Gallery of Catherine Bradford and Elizabeth Clay. Well, first of all then, it's my great, great pleasure to introduce my guests this evening. On my left, to the right of me, from your point of view, is Roberta Smith, co-chief critic, art critic of the New York Times, a job description that doesn't require much detail or amplification to back it up, because in our job, it kind of doesn't get much better than that. Then there's me, already been introduced. And to my right is Siri Hustvedt, distinguished, one of our great distinguished public intellectuals here in Brooklyn, here in America, the author of 10 books of both fiction and nonfiction. I recall the day when, as a boy, well, as you know, a young man. otherwise, she'd have been a girl, and that wouldn't have been
possible from a literary
point of view.
Go for it.
As a young person reading one of the English Sunday newspapers, I saw a photograph, and before I even had time to finish reading the review, was holding a copy of The Blindfold in my hands. She's the author of the best-selling What I Loved, a title that any art critic would want to get his or her hands on. She is a polymath. Besides her fiction and non-fiction, she holds a PhD in literature. She has given such distinguished lectures as the Freud Lecture in Vienna and the Schelling Lecture in Munich. She is a professor also of a lecturer in psychiatry at Cornell Weill, and she has lectured at museums and art schools on artistic subjects, including Goya at the New York Studio School. And the final guest, like Roberta, a veteran of the review panel, Alexei Wirth, the painter. He shows at DC Moore Gallery. He likes to insist that he's retired from the grubby day job of writing art criticism, but as somebody who is a lifelong servant of the 10th Muse, I never believe that anyone really retires from art criticism. David Sylvester in his 70s told me, you can't retire from art criticism. And he in his days as a jobbing critic, as it were, was read, even if his name wasn't always at the end of them, in the pages of The New Yorker, in the goings on about town, and in Art Forum. More recently, as a writer, he's transitioned to more scholarly and discursive writings, such as his riveting accounts of Manet and photography, which we've been reading in Cabinet magazine and other places. So, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome your panel. Great. Now, Siri and I are going to scoot around. This is the wonderful technology here that we can just do that. And we're going to see PowerPoint number one, and I'm going to shut up. Wonderful. Thank you very much. Great. Let's resume our approximate positions, if we like. Unless Roberta wants to fulfill her lifelong fantasy of being a Dalek. And anyway, that's the free form of this coffee table. It's so much nicer than that Politburo arrangement of a table behind which we all have to hide. And line up. Much more opportunities both for consensus and dissent when one is in a circle. So Glenn Leegan, usually when we have the PowerPoint presentations, I'm sort of embarrassed by the silence because it just leaves out the sense of reality, the whatever you hear when you're in a gallery, the receptionists chattering away, or the scraping of furniture as people do this and that. But here, actually, silence seems to be the essence of that experience, doesn't it? That we've got this homage to one of the great stand-up comedians of our time. The punchline is very literally robbed from us in this silent Richard Pryor. What is going on with the silence of Glenn Leegan, Alexei?
Well, one question to me is whether the press release is right about the text in Richard Pryor Live at the Sunset Strip that in the course of the performance, he says, when I get angry, I get silent. Mm-hmm. And the question is that the cue for the silence? That seems like a maybe a little bit of a narrow way to read it. So do we take the silence to be complicit with Pryor's anger and a way of kind of tacitly magnifying this note of anger? I don't think I do. I mean, I think that's what we're instructed more or less. I can't really, that seems opportunistic and out of key with the shrine-like admiration and tact of the piece as a whole. I can't entirely rule it out because it's true. I just rewatched Live at Sunset Strip this morning, and seeing it again, you think, oh, okay. But the piece feels like a lot of Ligon's work, more diplomatic, more deliberately hard to parse than that. And the silence leaves you, I mean, the silence makes it more like a painting, more like the practice out of which Ligon's work originally grows. And I found myself thinking it throws us back into Pryor's human affect, the kind of marked apprehensiveness that his face keeps falling back into. A sympathetic, almost loving, certainly admiring sense of this individual man without, you know, I didn't think of this when I first saw the piece, the black spaces, the pauses in the in the video are the audience, right? They're in the movie, there are all these panning shots of the mixed race, laughing, happy, cheerful audience. That's what's gone. Mm-hmm. And without them, it's more plaintive and poignant.
In the small screen, there's a moment during the cycle where you see the heads really like shadows of the audience.
Huh.
So that was an interesting thing. And then, of course, on the large screen, there's a screen where it's really focusing on Pryor's shadow.
Much of the
and,
time.
And this is really a kind of wonderful thing. I stayed there for a long time. And I think that's the trick, right? That you have to be turning and looking at those screens continually, and it becomes a kind of phenomenological adventure, if you will. And that you are continually have to shift your focus from different parts of this kinetic body that is moving all the time. And as it goes on, it becomes in a way more and more abstract and less Richard Pryor. Mm-hmm. But a kind of, for me, this encounter face to face, body to body, there becomes a kind of mirroring that happens between the spectator and these films or pieces of film. Mm-hmm. And, you know, listen, I left there, this is a little extravagant, but I started thinking about the philosopher Immanuel Levinas and his ideas about the face. And of course, for Levinas, it's not, the face is the other, but he's not talking about literal faces, that there's more to a being, you know, mm-hmm. than just the face. But this naked encounter face to face or body to body is a form of ethical demand. I found it very moving by the time I teetered out of there after,
an ethical hour. Demand that had less to do with who Pryor is and more to do with...
I think there's some context too, of course, because there's the sense that he is talking about black experience, and so depending, I think, on who the spectator is, some form of intersubjectivity or a relationship is established between the spectator and this man, this body, and that's certainly part of it.
And then what makes it all the more phenomenological is the isolation of the nonverbal language of the emoting body, the performing body, this hysteria of what one knows to be or guesses to be. imitations of other voices, because so much of Pryor's comedy is about embodying other voices.
Yes.
So that to remove the voice is to get this.
And of course, it's not funny.
It takes the punchline has really gone for a walk.
The humor is gone.
Yes.
Yeah.
Roberta, does this? Where do you feel Ligon is so much better known for his work with in painting, with this barely legible kind of painting, or the hard read, the slow read? Where does this departure do you feel fit with that program of delegibility?
Well, I've always found his work kind of opaque and very, very cool and conceptual. Mm-hmm. And I have issues with that. I thought this was one of the best things he'd ever done, and that he introduced a quality of unpredictability into his piece that hasn't been there before. And it depends on how much Pryor is in your head, how much you've seen of him. But, and I can't say I've seen a lot, but I loved the fact that there was no sound, and that you just saw the body, and that you just saw this kind of choreography that comes with his talking, and that you would never see that in quite the same way if you're listening to him talk and his amazing characters and his punchlines, and that you saw a whole other kind of effort and drama and involvement on his part. And if you knew him, you could see a lot, you could read his lips a lot. I mean, if you knew his performances, I beg your pardon. But if you had a sense of his, or memories of his performances, you could see him shift characters. You could see him do the old man with his mouth sort of closed up tight. And you could read his lips sometime. And I do think that, you know, I never really thought about the quote about anger. I mean, I read it, but I didn't think about it. But of course, that was one of his main conduits, was anger. Mm-hmm. He literally, this is a man who had a very explosive sensibility and understanding of what life was like, and who literally, excuse me, blew himself up. So it's just to see him looking so great in those colors, that orange
colors
suit
are
and
gorgeous.
The yellow flower, you know, I guess if you're in the audience, you know, there was some kind of like, what's that, a Barry Kieselstein cord belt? That was like... I loved all those details. It was an incredibly fashionable belt quite a while ago, right? I don't know. I thought it was... and then I also thought that you were in this space with these images coming and going, and, you know, each camera was focused on a specific body part, one hand or the other, his torso, his full length, and that what you had here was a really interesting dissection of a film shot. You know, each time you were seeing what was going on in a shot. And you could never have seen all that and picked all that out without this kind of almost cubist dissection. Mm-hmm. And the other thing that happened was that you were forced to do what he was doing, which was you were kind of roaming. You were roaming the space the way he was roaming the stage, to keep up with all the different views of him and the way they would come in and out. And I just thought it was, you know, I was really happy about it, because I haven't always been happy about his work. I found it, like I said at the beginning, a little too removed, and I don't know. I just thought this was more direct.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, and you know, the screens come on and off, so the kinetic energy of his performance is partly echoed in that movement of the screens churning on and off. There's a form of disorientation, you know, for the viewer, and I found that quite exciting.
Yeah, and obviously such a radically different experience from the static, massed audience of a Richard Pryor to being, for the most part, I mean, when I went there, it was the weekend, but I was the only person in the gallery, the solitary experience of wandering around with this bizarre artifact of a devocalized Pryor.
I was alone and I sat down. Mm-hmm. I just sat down on the dirty floor and pivoted. Right. And, you know, a couple times someone came. Mm. And then you think, you really can't see this thing unless you stay.
Wow.
You know, so I really recommend, if you haven't seen it, not to go in and walk out. I mean, there were people, they came and they looked around and then they left. Because you can't get anything.
Sure, it's not a purely physical thing.
I stayed a really long time. And I went out and I said to the people at the desk, I said, you know, because I just said, you know, in the studio, that piece Bruce Nauman did, you had chairs that you could roll around on. Remember
that?
Yeah,
like this. Yeah. That's right. Yeah.
You need a bench.
Yes.
They need a bench. Mm.
No, you needed to be able to move all the time because the images were just coming from all these different directions.
You need chairs like this.
Just perfect, this would be.
But at a certain point, like after about 40 minutes, I just said, okay. I get it. Yeah. My feet have.
But Siri was was uninhibited. Yeah. She got down and dirty with Richard Pryor. That's superb. Yeah. So, Alexei, the painting. What do you think that painting? Does that pivot?
As you walk in, the one from 2005 or whatever.
Mm. Yeah. 2004, I think. Yeah.
Well, it was absolutely a beautiful introduction to the piece. I didn't even ask. I mean, that's got to be Pryor as well.
Yes. And also, it's the red. It really picks up with his suit, doesn't it?
Yeah.
But I'm not sure what your question is about that piece. But
do you feel there's a convincing arc between the painting Irv that we know of Ligon that's represented in the show by the
the
single.
I'm not sure, but I share Roberta's hesitations or qualifications to some degree myself about some of that earlier work, which is enormously beloved and enormously influential. And on the one hand, I feel like in the last 10 years, I've seen huge numbers there's an enormous growth to me traveling around graduate schools in the level of young black artists and the promise of their work. It seems to me that very often the most interesting students are young African American students. That wasn't necessarily true 20 years ago. Mm-hmm. And I really think it is now. And they're all thinking about Glenn Ligon. He's a central presence for many, I would say the vast majority of young black artists who were dealing with identity. Not everyone is, obviously. Mm-hmm. But I think he's been more influential, if less visible, than somebody like Kara Walker. Hmm. And I think, in fact, he was a springboard for Kara Walker, whose very earliest pieces were text pieces. So he's huge. He's been a hugely enabling force. At the same time, personally, I share a feeling that the work is incredibly, its reserve seems astute and shrewd and enormously knowledgeable about how it synthesizes Nauman and Johns and other pieces of different forms of conceptualism and minimalism and pop. And it does so in a way, it brings to that a new subject for those physical forms of address. But it hasn't always, I've felt respectful and engaged, but not engaged past a certain level. And and truthfully here, I didn't either. To me, the most interesting question is Roberta's comment or about that this takes him to a new place or a new, is a shift or an interesting departure chapter, something like that in the work. I couldn't quite feel that here. There's a few pieces that break out in the history of his work, like the America Black Neons might be the ones I would choose. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. The Negro Sunshine, and yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But specifically the ones with the word America.
Uh-huh.
There's a bunch of variations. Here, I didn't get, with the seven screens, I didn't have your experience so much. I was thinking, God, this is such a shrewd, smart way to get this material, and the subject matter is in this year especially so deeply on our minds. Mm-hmm. But aside maybe from the color, which I think he tweaked interestingly, having rewatched the
gorgeous
movie, the movie looked totally different. It didn't have maybe it was the black room. I don't know. I suspect that he did stuff with the color.
And you know, there's a moment the glass of water comes, mm-hmm. and it's so beautiful. You know, it's almost like Chardin, and he's sitting then, and then you look, and he's got these gold shoes on, and that glass of water with lemons. I mean, it's really beautiful.
This
is my favorite thing that I've seen by him, too, And I'm I would not say that I'm an expert, but for me this was a motion to into something more, well, I'm going to use the word visceral.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, I think I think that he does something very special, which is that he's constantly sifting through this material. It's a very focused and form of appropriation at every turn. Mm-hmm. And he changes it physically, but it's almost like an editorial function.
Yeah.
You know, he figures out how to get things out of these things, show us further things about them.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, okay, Richard Wright's writing can be made into a painting. You know, I mean, that's what you get from that. Richard Pryor can be dissected into something completely other than, mm-hmm. you know, than we associate with him, which is a certain kind of point of view and sound.
Yeah.
But I think he'll always have that. That's why I'm not so worried about the continuity, because I think the continuity is way out here. It's not mm-hmm. from object to object.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he'll just jump around.
Mm.
It does seem, though, that there's, without there being any tension within it, some split between, on the one hand, a lexicon of concerns or a dealing with a canon of the black experience. So from that canon of the black experience, constructing works which then have a whole set of formal or phenomenological concerns, such as those that Siri has noticed and isolated, which essentially don't really have ostensibly or without a great deal of sympathetic contemplation on our part, any connection with the subject. For instance, the fashion details that Roberta's enjoying, right. the still life elements that Siri is picking up on, mm-hmm. the sense of fragmentation and cubism. These are a rich panoply of kind of formal and conceptual possibilities that don't necessarily or causally have anything to do with, with a deconstruction of the black American experience.
Yes.
Well, you could say that continuity is a kind of precision and cleanness,
mm-hmm.
and therefore focus,
mm-hmm.
and that he's always going to, there's something tight about his work that works for and against him. And I guess about the thing about this piece was that he kind of was breaking it up in a different way.
Oh,
but
I don't.
Still about, you know.
I don't doubt for a moment that everything he does will have his stamp on it, but that's not what I was saying. I was saying that within his approach, his finding these other qualities to concern himself with.
Yeah.
I mean, concerning himself with the color, for instance, of the enhancing or responding to the red, isn't per se an extension or continuation or of the, let's call it the black American thing.
Yeah, or the political message.
I
think that's, it's not Ajit Prop, right?
Right,
I mean,
right.
I think that there's a kind of ambiguity that's produced from the work, which makes it, not a slogan. It's not platitudes mm-hmm. about the black experience that we're supposed to be taking in, or slogans, whatever they happen to be. What interests me is, I think that I left there, as I said, feeling that the experience had the force of an encounter with another body, and that encounter felt that it had some ethical import.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. There's the element also of infatuation. I have an evolving canon within my own mind, maybe because it tallies with some of my own preoccupations, with artists who infatuate and fix themselves to idols or heroes, heroines, Joseph Cornell is probably the grand master of that oeuvre with his Lauren Bacall or Susan Sontag or whoever, and then there are others. So Richard Pryor, there's been Pryor, as it were, within Legon, and mm-hmm. clearly this is not just a convenient cipher for some interest in the black male or the black voice or whatever.
No.
This is Richard Pryor.
Yeah.
Right. Is that just his private affair and we should let him get on with it? Or is that infatuation folded into the work in some way, do we think, Roberta, for instance?
I don't know if I can answer that.
Okay, or anyone want to pick up
but
on
But I would like to say,
yes.
Yeah, say
yeah.
that I think that, as with John's, you could talk about him trying to be a different kind of artist, and that his ego is in a different place. And that that's, I wouldn't say that it's he's a fan or idolizing somebody, but he's mm-hmm. constantly, I mean, I'm kind of repeating myself,
yeah.
but he's constantly picking up these cultural, you know,
yes.
units, whatever you want to call them.
Mm-hmm. Signposts, maybe,
and
or something,
and
yeah.
yeah. it's better. And using them, and that's what I really like about his work, in a way.
Right, right. Well, the show's up for a while, I believe. It's up till, let's
April,
see.
I think.
Yeah, it doesn't tell me that. It's up for a while. So let's go back and spend, no, you can spend 88 minutes with it. It's an 88-minute long presentation.
80.
80? Okay.
80.
I'm cheating you of 8 minutes, sorry. Okay. Fantastic. I think we could carry on talking for a lot
yeah,
longer about...
Yeah.
About Ligon, and we might want to, we might or might not be happy to subtract it from our next discussion, but let's move nonetheless from Bushwick to Red Hook, where we've been to Pioneer Works and seen the work of Charles Harlan. I got to say, this is my first visit to Pioneer Works, which is something I probably shouldn't confess to publicly, because it's established itself as a important cultural resource in this borough and in the city. But it was a great pleasure to be there, especially when I looked at the ceiling. It is an extraordinary building, and it was an extraordinary building, and its repurposing is a riveting experience. Rivets might be the operative word, but... it's sometimes a problem, isn't it? If you can have an exhibition in a really sublime venue, does that exhibition really work with that venue in a creative way, or is it just get used to it? Okay, it's a beautiful building. Enough already. Look at the art, or is it, you know, if you put something in too good a frame, then it can be an obstacle. I don't know. What did you make of this experience, Siri? Did you...
There's always the little pause while we wait to see who he's going to pick.
Yeah.
I know.
And I have no idea who I'm going to pick, so it's...
You know, I think I'm 60 years old, and over time I've seen a lot of art, and this is... you know, continuing now a very old tradition of the ready-made. Mm-hmm. And it is a lovely space. and the things look really lovely inside that space.
Yeah.
But I guess I have to say that I didn't feel excited. It didn't generate a great deal of thought. And that might be my bias, that I like to, okay, I'll say exactly what I am looking for in works of art. I am looking for the excess that I do not understand, that I have to reach to get it. Now, I could always be wrong, and no doubt have been and will be, but I didn't feel that looking at those works, that there was a lot that was keeping alive this questioning, curious interest.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Right, right. So with the piece called Water, for instance, which is a 10 by 10 by 10 foot structure, when you go upstairs, you can look down and see in it this reflective pool. But from ground level,
yes, it
you
looks
have this
very,
very fine kind of brick structure. And it's
a cube and an
extension of, and but not necessarily an enhancement of, the great number of rich bricks that we have already in Pioneer Works. When I see a brick structure of a geometric form, Per Kirkeby immediately comes to my mind as somebody who the Danish neo-expressionist painter who's done so much with architecture and brick and so is so transformative. But then, I have this, and so I try to ignore the architecture, as it seems the artist probably has, and see what I can get from this work. And it's, for me, that's a work in progress. But I was hoping that Roberta or Siri or Alexei will put me on the right track. Roberta, enlighten us.
I was... This is an artist I've been interested in. He did a piece at JTT in the Lower East Side that was this enormous culvert, like, I mean, almost 12 feet in diameter, that had just barely been, if you've been to that gallery, it's barely 12 feet wide. So it had been fit in there, and basically it was just in there and kind of unsteady, so that when you walked through it, the whole thing would move back and forth a bit. And it was just, I thought, okay, this is somebody who... There was an element of perception and playing with the space and obviously setting up a major moving project. Mm. But I was extremely disappointed in this this show. I thought it was completely generic minimalism / post-minimalism, with the exception of, I don't know about Pierre Kirkaby, but I do know about Tony Smith, Donald Judd, a bunch of people using cubes. And I don't know, I find it kind of irritating that to get what the piece is about, you either have to read the wall and see that there's water in there, or you have to go up to the second or third floor and look down. That just irritated the hell out of me. and the chain link piece just seemed completely obvious. I mean, talk about lack of excess. That was just... There wasn't anything there. They would tell you. They told you that it came down 33 feet to the floor, so you knew how high the ceiling was. The best piece I thought was the one Shingles, which had this kind of funny play on Andre, and had a kind of experiential aspect in that when you walked on it, you knew there weren't many times you were going to be walking on shingles. If you're not a professional roofer, you're not really going to have that experience. So I just thought the way it felt to my feet was kind of interesting, and then I liked looking at it and seeing how it was put together. And then I got into the second space, and he put something on the wall, and I just thought, well, this guy doesn't get it. You know, he's working with space, and he's going to treat this place just like a gallery. So that was, he does these pieces where he finds trees that have grown into the chain link fencing, and then cuts out the square, and you sort of have this wall relief. They're okay. I mean, they're kind of interesting as just like nature did this. Mm-hmm. I can't say that I really like the space. I think that if you're going to redo a space, you redo it totally and you think about it totally. And for me, the standard is set by Donald Judd and the stuff he did in Marfa, where you look at the spaces and you don't really know what they were before. When I was in this space, I just got really sad about whatever the factory that had been there before and that it wasn't there anymore. And, you know, I just had the sense of things like clanking and whirring and people walking around. And
people employed, yes.
Then the best, and the best thing there for me was this guy out in the garden named Adam Stennett, who's spending a month in the garden. I mean, literally in the garden. He's built himself a 100-square-foot hut out of plastic, and he's got everything he's going to get. He brought with him to be there, and he's got a whole compost set up, and he's got a little heater that heats the place evidently really well at night, and he's collecting rainwater. And I just thought, I liked it. I just thought, well, this is not really new, but this is somebody doing something that's taking his full attention.
Yeah.
And that aspect of attention was very compelling.
Right. It did seem to be phoned in post-minimalism, didn't it?
And you didn't get it in Mr. Harlan's work, and you didn't get it in the way that space had been handled.
Right. Yeah. Alexei, it did seem to me, I must confess, rather generic. We've had a lot of... we've had decades to get used to environmental art, art et pauvre, post-minimal.
Yes.
By the way, with Kekabu, it's not that he made cubes, it's that he used bricks. So he makes these architectural sculptural effects with brick. So yeah, of course, the minimalists with the cube, that's they own the cube. But what's the agenda? What do you think he's trying to do?
Well, the theatrics of tonight's presentation suggest that I should find a way to disagree, if at all possible. And alas, I have to kind of glumly just say, I think you all said very well, more or less what I felt. And before I try to answer your question, I thought, Roberta, really, you changed how I felt about the roofing piece. That you improved it. Because by the time I walked around to that part, I felt I didn't trust the artist. I'd lost my appetite. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that happens. And now, in retrospect, I'm walking back over those tiles and having the feeling you describe, and it's much, it's got a little shiver of humor, which is something I'm always hoping to find. Not necessarily even like that I'm going to chuckle, but that the possibility of humor exists within the work, that there's a kind of amplitude of sensibility. Mm-hmm. Even like somebody like Glenn Ligon, that's true of. Even when the works are quite reserved, there can be wrynesses to them. Here I just didn't feel it, but I do think it was in the JTT piece, which felt like impossible and ridiculous and a kind of a beautiful goof. And some of his other pieces, there's some roll-up, like a roll-up gate and a piece that occupied a whole gallery that also felt like they felt they had some that humor, ridiculousness, a kind of, it didn't, here it felt like, David, you said phoned in, I was thinking kind of back of the napkin, like he was presented with an opportunity, and this is to me a kind of a disastrous problem that I associate with Masmoka and...
space to fill.
Well, that's space.
This is a mini Masmoka, isn't it?
Right.
Yes.
I feel like there's a use to artists who can be counted on to fill a giant acreage.
Yes.
And I don't think you want to be that artist who can just dependably do that in the way that he did here.
Yeah, but let me say that, you know, I think that the language, the visual formal possibilities thrown up by minimal, post-minimal land art, I would, earlier in my career as a stuffy conservative twit, I would have said, oh, it's been done, no need to reinvent the wheel. Now I'm coming round to saying, no, that's exclusionary, that's unfair. Look, these are components that can be reinvented and repurposed. And if you look at an artist like Song Dong, for instance, the Chinese artist, often using the forms from the generation of the 60s and 70s in a way that is fresh and pertinent and has vigor and purpose. So I don't think we should be accused of a snobbery against.
I don't think anyone wants to throw out cubes.
No.
For example, but I mean, really,
sure.
in that sense, that there's a kind of pluralism. Clearly, I mean, if you look at the four shows that were picked for this panel, pluralism is the order of the day, and I think that's good. But it's weird that some cubes.
Yes.
Address you with a rigor and necessity sometimes I don't understand why.
Some cubes are more cubist than others.
You know, what? But then I did not feel that.
Yeah.
You know, you can walk in, there's a judge show that might still be at Zwirner. No, it was a while ago.
A little while ago, yes.
Yeah. And, you know, you walk in and you see these. But they are... They have power.
They reinvent themselves.
Yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
Exactly. Okay, I think we might cruel to continue.
Okay. Yes,
But do go and see Harlan in Red Hook. And now is a great moment. So we got some roving mics, and this is where we get a chance to hear some of what you might be dying to say. Either in defense of Harlan, perhaps, or some probing critique that we missed of Ligon, or whatever you have to say. Absolutely. And we'll take comments on either show.
I've got a mic for you.
And there's I'll a mic around. Coming round.
I see your from hand.
Are they going to put up the lights a little?
Yeah, let's put the lights up a little. That would be great. Yeah, so we can at least see you, so it's not a
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, yeah. Oriane Stender. We can hear you and see you.
Back to the Ligon show. I love Richard Pryor, and I like Glenn Ligon quite a lot. And I'm kind of wondering if there was a sort of a whitewash of the show's title. And by whitewash, I'm not even referring to a bunch of white people talking about
right.
a black artist, quoting a black artist who talks about the black experience. That's like another whole layer.
Yeah.
But I think the title of the show is something like, it's time to
we
wake
gotta
up.
We got to wake up because that's what time it
that's
is.
What
because
it
that's
is.
What's time, well, yeah.
Well, my brother and I used to listen to Richard Pryor records a lot in high school. And to this day, we could still crack each other up by saying, someone says, what time it is? What time is it? The answer is, time for you to quit fucking with me. we will like call each other and say that and crack each other up. So I'm kind of wondering if that was really the title of the show, and maybe luring Augustine said, well, you know, we can't really like list that
in
the New York Times.
Right.
Because I've never heard that.
So as an expert on Richard Pryor, you would recognize
not
that. You w- you
the
might
nuanced,
recognize
yeah.
this, it's time to wake up.
Well, that I've not heard. I'm not an uh-huh. expert, but I certainly remember time for you to quit fucking with me. And I do not remember because that's what time it is. So I'm just wondering about that.
Don't you think the New York art world can stand that?
Yeah, I'm not sure that's so likely, but I also think it's a great title. The
I
title that he chose.
That he chose,
yeah.
Yes, yes.
It's time to wake up because that's
it's not a sanitized,
yeah.
It's not a
doesn't
not a
satisfy
compromise.
Your family yes. imperatives as much, I'm sorry.
Anyway, let's hear for more.
Oh, hi, I actually work at Luring Augustine. So
excellent, great.
Answer, tell us.
Shed some light. So Glenn said the title comes from...
Oh, good.
He overheard a radio talk show, and one of the women, or one of the people calling in, that was a comment to the issue being discussed, was we need to wake up because that's what time it is.
No, that's
so
nice.
As far as I know, it doesn't come from Pryor at all.
Okay.
Right.
Oh, good.
Fantastic.
Thanks.
Thanks for that clarification.
That's very
great.
Good. Inside knowledge.
Yeah, the best. Yes. There's lots of hands going up. I'm going to leave it to Joel.
Going to the back. Be patient.
I keep thinking about the prior piece, the piece that's in the White House, right? There's a
yes.
there's a Ligon piece
yes.
right.
Yes.
Up in the White House now.
Okay, so.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Good evening, panel. My name is Stanley Cohen, and I'm a no relation. And I am a photographer, and the PowerPoint presentation was just awful for me. how dare they put red on blue? Impossible, and the images were blurred, but what I did get out of it was...
Use the mic, because we don't want to miss a single word of this.
thank you, David. Was Richard Pryor comic genius? And I think you all missed it. You didn't say one word about his comic genius. And every time I looked at Richard Pryor, I saw his comic genius.
Well, now you've said it, and we totally agree.
But we're all down with that.
Yes.
We probably
felt we didn't need to say it because it's actually one of those things. This man is acknowledged by comedians, you know, everywhere as one of the great, brilliant, extraordinary geniuses.
That he does. Do you know any of his bits at all? Well, he does a bit separating the relations between black and white. And the bit is very simple. There's two guys walking down.
No, we can't take off.
We love Richard Pryor. We love Richard Pryor.
No.
Stop. Move on or say something to us that matters.
I'm trying to.
No, but not about Richard Pryor. About the art we're talking about.
Let me finish what I'm trying to
say. No, because you're off topic. You're not talking about what we're talking
about. We're not reviewing Pryor. We're reviewing Ligon.
We agree already.
I know. I said that already. But you missed the target. The guy missed the target.
Right.
Okay, that's your statement. The,
okay.
Let's leave
Joel,
it.
let's come back to this gentleman a little
Who's
later.
Next?
Thank you.
Hands.
Great. Some more.
Is someone on the right over here?
Yes, that's, there oh. we are. Right
here. Some 40 years ago, as the project designer of the East Building of National Gallery of Art with Ian Pei, I had the opportunity to be there when we commissioned Sandy Calder to do a huge mobile, the biggest mobile he did just before he died. In order to evaluate the work, we had a huge model, and Sandy Calder brought in this little marquette, hung it in the model, Ian Pei, Carter Brown, director of the National Gallery of Art, and a few of us funkies.
Use the mic, please.
And a few of us flunkies were a little bit around it.
Yes.
And at one point, Carter turned to Sandy and said, Sandy, don't you think it needs a certain je ne sais quoi, blah, 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 blah. And he went on for about a few minutes. At the end of it, Sandy Calder, standing there in his jeans and his plaid shirt, his tie, stewed to the gills, turned to him and said, you better type that up for me, which is my comment on the extent to which so much fatuous affability is talked about art than what an artist says himself. When you see that show and you say phoned-in minimalism, well, now, I'm a big fan of Robert Irwin from way back.
A fan of who? Irwin, did you say?
Irwin.
Robert
Irwin, yes.
Yep. Just
I remember the first show I saw at Irwin, which was in 1971 at the Walker in Minneapolis.
Mm-hmm.
And he had done a scrim against the wall with light behind it. And you were utterly blown away.
I'm sure. But
we're not critiquing
minimalism
Irwin.
Per se.
We're just talking about
Charles Harlan.
No, I'm talking about the way you people criticize art. That's what I'm talking about.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
Okay, thank you.
I saw one over here.
I didn't.
It's getting
I didn't
very
understand.
Meta.
He's saying that
I
it's
think phoned-in minimalism is.
Okay, right. Gentleman in the front, come on. Joel, it's up to you, yes.
I would just like to refer to the cube with water. Is the title of that show Flood?
Yes.
Yes, it is.
Yeah. Well, I think that space was.
Flooded,
yeah.
No doubt, Red Hook, yeah.
So, I mean, it might be a little bit more than...
It's true. The funny thing I kept thinking about, I thought it might be a possibility, but thanks for telling us. There's no feeling of flood
and
in
it's
the...
It's even worse. I feel like we're dumping on it. This is a young artist who, to me, has done other interesting work. It felt totally opportunistic to use Sandy. That's how I felt about it. Again, you come to these works, and it's a matter of the work establishes a kind of trust, or it doesn't. In this case, maybe that's a pessimistic or cynical way, but the work didn't get me to a point where I believed like everything's in play here. That could be a meaningful element. Instead, it just felt like I'll use that.
Yes. Yes.
And I think the other thing is that he responds to space, and I'm not. I would almost blame it on the space in a way. I mean, I think he could have looked at the space and said, no, there's nothing for me to do here, the way he did at JTT. But that he was really sort of done in by trying to deal with that space. That's why the piece with the shingles was better, because it was more contained.
Let's
take one more comment from the front. Yes.
But lots of great artists can be foiled by a space, and the Tate Modern space is a case in point. The Unilever series has messed up more artists' career than probably anything else. Artists after artists, other than like Olafur Eliasson, he did a great piece and it was great, but so many great artists have failed at that space.
Sure.
So it really has to be the right artist, the right space, and they have to commune.
Right.
About the Glenn Ligon, I thought you guys were missing some things about Glenn Ligon's piece that were essential to me, and that, I grew up only being able to have Glenn Ligon, to have Richard Pryor as a voice on a tape recorder because he wasn't allowed in the house. So this was very strange to me that the image of him was in the house, but it wasn't then his voice. I only had his voice outside the house on a bootleg tape, me and my friends, and we were 10 and we were giggling. And then, so that's this sort of weird personal thing that I have with it, which I think also probably Glenn Ligon had growing up in a house not too dissimilar from mine. I mean, I remember when Thelma Golden basically came out for Glenn Ligon at his show on Broadway for him, because they didn't know, like, there were all of the magazines under the bedspreads, and it was a recreation of his bedroom, and they didn't know what that was. So she had to tell them. So I think that there's this weird flipping there for if you were an African-American kid and you're growing up and Richard Pryor is not an in-the-house thing, then there he is in the house, in the perfect house, but then he's silenced. And then I went to another level with it, which is that as he's silenced, I realized that all of his jokes are about his being lynched. He's constantly being lynched, and he's mad about it, and he tells these jokes, and comedians are fucked up, and they tell these jokes so they can get out of this. And then he never gets out of it. And his lynching, his constant lynching, is this story that ends with him exploding himself. And then Ligon explodes him again and lynches him again for us. So this was a terrifying piece for me. So I was terrified because I'm in the piece, and it's a horror film. Because I can see every little, it's like being at a lynching, and he's musing with this feeling that you're at a lynching and you're enjoying every little tendon moving in his face is terrifying.
Right.
Well,
okay.
How is it?
That's so deep.
That was super, so interesting.
It
but
is.
But I don't understand how it's a lynching. The background.
He's dangling there without a voice. When you take away Richard Pryor's voice, you are lynching him again. And Ligon is doing that usefully. You guys have not been lynched. You've not been silenced.
No,
right. You're not silenced. So that is why you missed it. It's very obvious, but it's perspective.
It's perspective, and but I think you're absolutely right. And one of the things that I wanted to say about my experience was precisely that there is a relationship that's set up, and your relationship to this work will be be different, of course.
Fantastic.
Boy, I have to say, you're bringing material in that, as I said, the nervous energy of that man had a very powerful effect on me. Watching him touch himself, watching his beautiful hands move, the kinetic energy was extraordinary. But the idea that Ligon is putting the spectator in the position of lynchers, That seems hard for me to.
There's a lot to digest there, but I think what you've really got with Pryor is that with Ligon is that the extent to which there is a deconstruction here cannot be overemphasized because so much of Pryor is actually about imitation, and so some of those jokes are his mafia jokes. So they're actually about Italians, and it's him doing an Italian voice with just such riveting plausibility. and you talk about lynching, that in the Italian, he goes in and threatens to shoot these mobsters with a toy gun, and there's a whole scenario that follows from that, and his being adopted by these mafiosi into their family because they're just so riveted by that, they're just so enthralled by that performance. So. Yeah, I mean, one doesn't want to make light of lynching, but I do want to get your agent's name by the end of the evening so we can book you for a future review panel, sir. Thank you very much indeed. Let's actually move on let's move to the city, as it were, and have a look at what's at Canada, Bradford and Clay. Excellent. And a good moment perhaps to, well, a good moment definitely to acknowledge and thank my associate publishers, my associate publisher, Sasha Berendt, and my long-time assistant and publishing associate, a different job, Anna Shukilo, for their input in these, despite what the professional photographers might say, to my humble opinion, rather fine PowerPoint presentations. Mr. Cohen, you may be right, but you should have seen how terrible they used to be. So, anyway. So we go from the flood in Bushwick to a fear of waves on the Lower East Side. Roberta, you've been writing about Catherine Bradford for quite some time, and perhaps indeed you are one of the critics who've helped establish a reputation that I, as a relative newcomer to her work, pleased to have established. She's one of my favorite New York painters, and I was enthralled to see a new genre in her work. Those of us already in awe of the supermen and of the ships protruding from the wall and floor, have not just a new motif in swimmers and the sea, but a stunning command, to my opinion, of scale in these works. Are you, like me, welcoming of these departures and expansions in her?
Well, I hadn't realized I've written about her so much, but...
Well, I just saw something from early in her career is what I meant
right,
to say.
That's one thing that happens, you forget.
Yes.
I thought that I was really glad to see the boats go. Okay. I found them very distracting. She used to paint these big kind of children's storybook boats. They were very appealing on water. And
they were appealing, but you were pleased to see them go?
Right.
Okay. Right?
Yeah.
No, sure, that's fine.
They were ingratiating.
Okay. Right.
So I felt like she'd gotten to some place that was real. It's a good start where she is now. I'm still not that crazy about the figures, but the thing about her work is basically it's the way it's painted and the relationship between what she's painting and the liquidity of paint and the liquidity of the ocean. And I just found it much more, I mean, I really can't say much about it because I just found it much more compelling to look at and to figure out how they were made. And, you know, in a really small painting, I don't know. I mean, I actually only liked about half the paintings in the show. I liked the darker ones a lot better. And, although that one was okay.
That's
just about looking at what she was doing with paint and how she, I mean, it's sort of like Avery, you know, doing something that's kind of abstract and then you suddenly see it as depicting something. And just, you know, she's great with material.
Right, right. Great material, ingratiating. Are those satisfactory, Alexei, or do we need to see?
Ingratiating is a criticism, David.
Yes, I realize.
Yeah, we got that.
I realize.
We got that.
I like ingratiating paintings, but maybe it's a double-edged word. I am.
Well, it's saying too pretty. It's a Wittgenstein. Nothing that's pretty can be beautiful. So if it's ingratiating, presumably it's not.
You can have a predilection for the prepossessing.
Yes.
The ingratiating.
Whoa.
I'm a little bit friends with the artist and have known her work for a long time and have admired it and am. Like, I think a lot of her wide acquaintanceship in the art world, super psyched to see her work reach a bigger audience at a gallery that has a different kind of cachet. And her best paintings I love. Mm-hmm. And some of the ones I would include in that category include some of the ships, which were, to me, importantly, it was important that they were the Titanic. Which wasn't always clear. Sometimes it was just a ship. And I, on the other hand, I did think she stayed on board for maybe a little too long. I'm sounding like David now. Mm. that I think she had a little bit of an idée fixe that like the economy was the Titanic or American culture was the Titanic or some sort of little bit overly heavy-handed metaphor in her mind mm-hmm. about a kind of portentous and yet childlike and funny metaphor. I love some of the Supermen also. I felt that way about, and I think the clumsiness of her work. Knowing clumsiness is can be tremendously successful, or it can fall surprisingly flat. And so, in this show, for me, the big Fear of Waves green painting with 36 figures was totally surprising, totally fresh, delightful. And some of it, like you find to me in the figures, surprisingly well drawn figures mm-hmm. alongside ones where she's, you know, again, entirely consciously but ham-handed. The other one that I really loved were the two swimmers, or maybe it's three, in a green painting with a lane.
The lanes, the pool,
right.
Yeah.
I thought that was a dazzling painting, and that just the very simply laid out shadows underneath kind of like floated those figures up towards our faces, and it felt so so beautifully made, and the color was terrific. The others, I liked the cosmic hot tub one as well.
Yes.
But there were others where I felt like the things she's doing, shifting to acrylic, didn't necessarily, to me, pay off. That I missed some of the you know meatiness of the oil paint.
The succulents.
In her early work, mm-hmm. In almost all the other paintings, but on the whole. I feel like three super strong paintings, I'm more than happy.
Yeah. I think technically the shift to acrylic has enabled the increase in scale, don't you think? I mean, I'm always in awe of painters who can get from acrylic some of the succulents and satisfactions of oil. It's, you know, Merlin James would fit into that category as well for me.
Right. Merlin is a kind of interesting connection.
I think so. I think so. The construction of a naivete within a highly sophisticated frame. Yes. But Siri.
I also write novels, so I'm a bit of a sucker for narrative elements, especially these mysterious narrative elements. And that the guy sitting around the hot tub, that's called Fathers.
Yes. And.
I was like, what are those fathers doing there?
What are they fathers of?
I think, you know, that for me, this the playful, whimsical, but also there are these almost galactic elements, you know, with the planets. And I don't know, I thought those juxtapositions were very pleasing, and I understand... ingratiating because there's a border there, you know, that it can tip at times. But I actually like that pink painting. You know, you do think about Bonnard too, with some of the colors and some of the women under those beautiful Bonnard bathers, you know, where the bodies start to shiver underneath the water. And I think she does that very well. And then that pink, what is it called? It has like a pink wall, and then there are bathers in front.
Oh yeah,
and
the swim club.
Guy in a strange suit on the left.
Swim club, I think. Miami
it's
swim
like,
club.
It's like you have an abstract painting at the top, and then you have these little people.
At the bottom. That bewildered me a little bit, that painting.
But I thought it was kind of nifty.
Right.
But again, you know, it's this, the question of.
Well, I like the idea of the narrative in a way with all that kind of painting going on. Because you look at them and you think, well, a lot of this stuff goes on, you know, sort of. I mean, this is very vague. But some of the effects she had when you got up really close and look at color under color and the way things came through, or you looked at the edges.
Yeah.
It's like she's saying, you know, we did color field painting, and there I still have something to do with this.
Yeah.
With all those techniques and all those colors. And it's going to be about... more directly about life.
Yeah.
And I think that there's a lot of figurative painting that does that, saying, you know, okay, this stuff isn't done. It isn't used up, but I can find more.
Absolutely. Yeah. So and it's also revisiting.
Put it in a different context.
Yeah. But also, I mean, Jad, who we know you revere, I mean, you've mentioned him this evening.
David, and don't. Don't talk about how I feel about things, okay?
Okay. Right. Well, some people might be under the thrall of Judd, for instance. And that might, not no present company excluded, but there are some who might accept some of that puritanical stricture that, that holds in suspicion beauty or pleasure or fun or narrative or personalism, and who might see as you know, some degree of compromise the willingness to go to a place which is a very peculiar hybrid of yes. abstraction and personalism, yeah. for instance,
yeah. Yeah.
Mastery of technique and a deliberate quirky naivete, and they work together. They can work together, but they can also be held in suspicion. So that was just the point I was going to make. But to me the father's painting was the take home painting. I mean, there were a lot of winners and hitters, I thought, in that
yeah,
show. But
yeah, like
the father's painting was so ambivalent. You guys have already alluded to the fact that it's marine and astral at the same time.
Yeah.
So we've got, you know, they're in a hot tub, but that hot tub is floating in outer space.
And they just have their legs in.
Yeah, and also they are, until I saw the title, I was pleased by their intersexual status, because their gender was highly ambivalent.
Yes.
Then fathers, well, that happens to be the title. It doesn't necessarily mean they
but
are the fathers,
fathers,
but
no.
they may be fathers. But they seem to be genderless or intersexual.
Well, and they seem to be naked, and they have no penises.
That's right.
So I mean, really, if you go up and you look, and I got very interested in the male female thing, because the only way you can tell the bodies apart are bathing trunks, and whole piece or two piece bathing
mm-hmm.
suits. That's
mm-hmm.
real. Those are the signs of sex.
Yeah.
Of sexual difference in the piece, so in all the paintings. So I started thinking, and some of them have all men,
mm-hmm.
and some of them have mixed.
Yeah.
And then, I think that were there any all women?
That's a very good question.
I don't know.
It would make sense that there might be, if one could allow biography to influence how one reads a painter's work, but perhaps one shouldn't. In the past, her work has really been about a gay woman's celebration of a new kind of manhood. There was mm-hmm. a painting called The New Man, and the supermen as non-Ubermensch-y kind of supermen,
yes.
as kind of the pathos of her spandex-clad heroes. It seemed to be about it's a celebration of something transcending the received perceptions of gender.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
I think that there's something of that going on in these paintings
yes.
as well.
Although yeah. I tend to read them more narrowly, as a painter, as pictorial metaphors, as like Superman is the kind of great tradition of painting that's now a little bit middle-aged and enfeebled, mm. or a listing ship that's going to go down but has a little bit more life in it, or even a little splash in some shallow water
mm-hmm.
for the final sunset hours of the medium.
Yes. And also the fear of the fear of waves. I mean, the color field would
yes.
and the oceanic and the astral. And going big and swimming in the ocean with those big waves, there's certainly a correlation between metaphors. The painting metaphor is striking, isn't
yeah.
it?
Yeah.
It's possible. Yeah. The PowerPoint seems to be telling us that we should be
yes,
moving on.
It is.
So we can't argue with technology. Let's do so. Let's take a moment to think about the pairing. I mean, we don't often, we have a sort of, I have an unwritten rule of, you know, there's so many galleries out there, I'm not just going to be lazy and convenient and do two shows in one gallery for the sake of it. But to my mind, were two shows that really did equally deserve
mm-hmm.
attention. So we're thinking now about Elizabeth Clay in the adjacent space, but some commonality of sensibility, Alexei?
Well, of touch, anyway. There's. I mean, I'm interested. It sounds like such a generic word, but I'm interested in clumsiness and how you can sometimes have a kind of knowing, narrow, apparent clumsiness that's not simply a lack of skill, but a kind of a way of relaxing your hand and treating things that can be surprisingly interesting. And to me, those two shows shared that. They shared, I suppose, you know, a kind of thoughtful hedonism as well. Mm-hmm. I don't know how much consequence the clay show was. I wanted it to be more because I enjoyed those objects greatly. I felt like the glazes, the little tincture of color leaking out of the black-white
like
changes.
Too. It gets almost bluish.
Right.
Yeah.
Can we just make a larger point just for the audience that didn't see the show? On the other side of every vase or container, it flips. The white becomes black and the black becomes white. So there's kind of optical quality.
Yes, that's key. And then that ties in, doesn't it, formally with the use of woodblock, and that's the negative and the positive flipping in the way of making woodcut or relief prints. Yes, good point, and thank you very much. And does that provide the conceptual key for you for the show?
The fact that it flips.
Yes, and the fact that it's the
well,
positive,
it makes it visually more interesting. But I wouldn't call it the key. I mean, the key is what. How do you use the history of ceramics to make new ceramics?
Yes.
And I felt that she was depending a little too much on the history, although I sort of felt exactly as I felt with the Bradford show, like that this took her to a different level and it made me more interested, and I basically wanted to see what's going to happen in the next two or three shows, that she sort of I've watched her work and I've been kind of drawn to it, but not really taken with it. Mm-hmm. And I really like these. I don't know how, I don't know if I give them. I mean, I wouldn't mind living with one of them.
Mm. Right.
You know, and I don't know quite.
Yeah.
If that would how that would go over, you know, because
that's not allowing yourself to be
ingratiated. Well, I don't know what their prices are. If they're priced as pots or they're priced as art, you know, it's like you get a different attitude expressed in that.
Yeah.
Okay.
But and I like the fact that they were sort of majolica, right? I mean, that's one of the sources, and yet they were black and white. Or I always thought it was very dark blue and white. So then I thought it was kind of playing on the tradition of blue and white. But
I also love the wallpaper. I thought that, really made it into a very powerful installation. Not the wallpaper; it's the print on the wall, but the wall
the
treatment.
Side, yeah,
yes,
the side banners or whatever.
I can't say I've decided or worked out what it means, but it just was giving me pleasure and provoking thoughts. And just as very traditional vessels that really, because of that quirky handmadeness about them, seem to really be generating possibilities. What was your feeling, Siri, overall?
Well, of course, you know, I see the name of the show, so I instantly, you know, think about the Shelley.
Shelley, yeah.
And, of course, I mean, it's a very short poem, but, and there is a quality of excavation, an idea of, you know, the relic, but it's not a relic, it's new. Which is, of course, a reference to the poem, but the Shelley is much darker than the feelings that...
It's about hubris, isn't it, really?
Yeah, it's about the terrible hubris of, you know, the King of Kings, and there's this monument, and the traveler is telling the poet, really, it's mostly a quotation about how, you know, now he's just a ruin.
Yes. Now it's just dust in a flask.
But you don't really, the show doesn't, it might, you know, maybe there's, I mean, I think she's talked about mortality as, you know, something that's part of her thinking.
Yeah.
Making these pieces, so it might be a reference to that. I mean, using the poem as a...
Mm-hmm. But did it feel like there's some kind of real affinity or connection to you?
With the poem?
Yeah.
No, there's one line. I mean, it's really short. This is it. I met a traveler from an antique land who said, quote, two vast and trunkless legs of stone stand in the desert. Near them on the sand, half sunk, a shattered visage lies, whose frown and wrinkled lip and sneer of cold command tell that its sculptor well those passions read, which yet survive, stamped on these lifeless things, the hand that mocked them and the heart that fed. And on the pedestal, these words appear. My name is Ozymandias, King of Kings. Look on my works, ye mighty, and despair. Nothing beside remains. Round the decay of that colossal wreck, boundless and bare, the lone and level sands stretch far away. End quote.
Wow. You come to Brooklyn Public Library, you hear poetry. That's...
It's a beautiful poem.
It's a great poem, and it's...
And Shelley was like 22 when he wrote it, too.
Yes.
He was
and
a
young it's a pretty august and possibly portentous sentiment to accompany a show of nine flasks, some wallpaper, and some...
That's...
Yeah.
I agree.
Yes.
I mean, I think that's it. That maybe... maybe one should think a little more carefully about the literary reference.
Yes. Yes, yes, right, right.
Well, I can just imagine her saying, oh, I always liked the word.
Yes.
As her defense.
It's a wonderful word.
It's a real jewel of a word. I mean, it's just such an amazing word.
Yes, and so rolling it around in your mouth is a good feeling.
But then she should have called the show like Ozymandian, maybe.
Yeah.
Well, yes.
There's a thought.
I was a little annoyed. I mean, it's fun to hear... arguably maybe the greatest poem in the language or one of the top 10.
Well,
but no, let's not get carried away.
Oh, no. I think
you
it
love
is.
It.
Really?
I don't think it's one of the top 10, but it's a great
it's
poem.
It's a perfect poem. Let's leave it there then.
One of the top 10 Shelley poems.
Who knew we were going to have literary fights up here?
Yeah, right. You thought the night is young. We dealt with art. Come on, roll your sleeves up. 10 best poems.
But I think...
Anyway.
I have a list right here.
Right.
I think it was a slightly irritating note that it seemed like it seemed nervous. It seemed like a nervous gesture on the artist's part to add a little historical gravitas in a way that seemed out of key with the spirit of the work.
Yeah.
Right.
And likewise, I thought that some of her comments, because I did some homework and was reading interviews where she's talking about how she loves drag queens, and I didn't trust that's really where the work comes from, and that she needs it. It felt like a little bit of a nervous infill backstory, but I think the work has some real strengths, and I feel like she should set aside these those nervous gestures.
Yes,
and I felt both it and both it and Kathy Bradford's show, to me, had an interesting quality of being so near to being something much less interesting, depending on kind of quirkiness and charm, as they both partly do, is a very tricky thing to depend on. And yet, I felt like they turned something slight into something that had amplitude and weight. I appreciated both of them more for that.
Yeah. Right, right. You have the fear of waves, you have the fear of sand, if you're Ozymandias. Right. There are elements and there are emotions there.
But, you know, there is something kind of both vegetal and anatomical about these forms. You know, bulbous, like organs, you know, and they're not perfect. And that imperfection, I find fetching.
Wabi, what do they call it in Japanese?
Wabi-sabi.
Wabi-sabi, yes.
Oh, yeah.
But the other thing is that, and I meant to say this before, that one of the things that seemed to me precarious about her work is that it's so cross-cultural. Like the emblems, she says sometimes they're Islamic, sometimes they're maybe a little bit
Greek. It has a very Romanesque feeling, the whole
Matisse,
show.
They're Matisse, she's pulling in a way that could be just sloppy and vague. And yet, it didn't feel like it dragged me down with them. It felt some weirdly, surprisingly, that was okay.
That it was synthesized.
Yeah.
Yeah. Certainly. Yeah. 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 I agree.
a modernist for all her love of drag queens. Right. Ladies and gentlemen, let's open these two shows up for comments from the floor. Kathy Bradford, Elizabeth Clay. Elizabeth Clay, by the way, should be acknowledged as a former review panelist. And
oh, there you go.
Oh, yeah.
Hopefully future one, too. Yes. I mean, sometime Times critic. Correct? Yes.
I just wanted to comment on...
Use the mic, because I can hardly hear you. Sorry.
Hi, Siri.
Hi, Maria.
Maria Friedrich. I wanted to comment on Clay's work.
A little louder.
Just speak into it.
Close.
Like a singer, like Richard Pryor or something.
My name is Maria Friedrich, and I wanted to comment momentarily on the Clay objects under discussion. I saw the show, and I thought what struck me about it was the quality of the surface, and the immediate reference was Mimbres pottery, which has a history of complete loss. The pots exist and no one quite knows what happened to the makers. And I think that the world is right now undergoing an extraordinary tsunami of destruction of relics in sacred places, and power, as influenced by somebody like a Cleopatra or others, is demonstrated in the broken objects of those societies. And I think that the pots, for me, having looked at ceramics from around the world, from Taraskan pottery to fine Japanese pottery, and particularly to decorated surfaces, are actually an extraordinary assimilation of the decorous surfaces that we find in societies where those relics of time lost are actually being systematically destroyed. So it was a really curious, and also the whole thing of the black facing the white, the converse, was actually very, very interesting as well. But the leakage, Siri, as you notice, of the blue is like this unbelievable color of hope.
Yeah, it's a beautiful color.
It's like softens the confrontation of black and white. So it was a very moving exhibition, but it is in that crazy border of being both decorative and being an object that's asking to be seen as a sculptural work and taken seriously.
Yep.
So
thank
there you.
Thank you very much indeed.
No. No, I think it was good to bring out this. It was very good, I think, to bring out this idea of looking at these kinds of ceramic pieces often as not sculptural, not art, that it's a form of lower.
Yes.
So that's. I think that's very important. No one mentioned it, but I think that's right.
Well, in a way, it's our liberation from that hackneyed way of thinking that would designate.
And from those hierarchies.
Those hierarchies of high and low and fine and applied. Absolutely.
Yeah.
There are so many artists working so creatively. You know, Betty Woodman is like the is such a high example of that of exploding those distinctions, those snobbish distinctions. Yes, Roman.
Hi. Looking at the Catherine Bradford show and everything, it was reminded of another work. Oh, it's a one piece show at a Petzl Gallery by Thomas Eggerer called. I can't remember what it's Water World, I believe, and it's kind of like one of the one of Bradford's bather pieces, sort of blown up, you know, 10 feet by 12 feet, I believe, takes up the entire room, and I just thought it was an interesting coincidence that both of those are on display, you know, just across town from each other at the same time.
Yes, yes, absolutely.
But they're painted.
Do you remember the title, Noah? You wrote about the painting, the egg era. Do you remember the title of it? Waterworld, yes.
Okay.
You're right. They're completely different.
They're bathers.
They've got water in common.
Yeah.
Hi. Sorry, I do have a question, not a comment. Oh, that's okay.
That's okay.
It might be another possibly irrelevant connection. I wonder if anyone can illuminate it for me. The wall treatment in the Elizabeth Clay made me think a lot of some paintings that Christopher Wool did a long time ago with, I think he made them with rollers that kind of make wallpaper-like patterns, but they seem like two completely opposite painters. Is there a hidden connection?
I would say between Christopher Waller and Glenn Ligon, there's a connection.
Yeah.
He was in the back of my mind when we were talking about Ligon. But clay, well, I don't think anyone has a monopoly on stencils and black and white, really. That's if there is one to be made, I would look to someone like Barry Schwabsky to illuminate it for me. But and that was indeed past and future review panelist Barry Schwabsky who put the question. Does anybody, Roberta, did you see a Christopher Wall connection?
No.
No.
They seem like, on the surface...
It's all Barry.
It would seem the pleasure of the wall drawings was seeing her try to draw the get the proportions right without any measuring.
Right.
You'd see like a form that would be squashed because she didn't leave enough room, and then she'd try in the next panel to leave extra room, and then the other side would get squashed. And there's a sort of comedy there of like doing freehand something that really requires measuring.
Yeah.
It seemed like entirely the opposite of a stencil where none of that is an issue.
Yeah, it'd be fun to put that next to the
But I
Charles
thought Barry
Harlan
was going
to
get over to pattern and decoration, actually.
Yes.
That's what I was anticipating.
But the awkwardness that comes from painting on a vessel is the response of a two-dimensional form to a three-dimensional support. And so it becomes maybe a stylized extension of that to get that awkward hand on the wall where there's no real resistance beyond the fatigue or incompetence of the artist. Just a thought. But I mean, I like, again, the wall treatment as in the other works in that show, that quirky hand. Yes, Suzanne.
On the subject of two and three dimensional going together, I do think that the Thomas Edgar had Water World has a lot to do with what Catherine Bradford is doing in those paintings. They're both making a kind of deep space that's completely flattened out by the figures. And I wondered if anyone on the panel wants to say anything about whether they think of the Edgar as being not being ingratiating. But I do think that there is a real relationship.
Well, the Edgar is so clearly photo-derived. This is the show, the painting, the single painting show at Petzl. Is so clearly photo-derived, and it is also about an entirely synthetic, alienated environment. Waterworks is a kind of Disney-like sort of swimming environment. So whereas the Bradford is so much more empathetic and oceanic, and that's why I feel that emotionally they're in just completely different registers. But it is Roman is good to bring it up because it just shows you can have a comparable motif showing at the same time and show the actual amazing sort of diversity of what can be done or not done in art. Yeah. Let's take three more and then call it a night. Yes. Thank you.
Hi, Marianne Barcelona. I just feel that there's a little bit of a lost opportunity here that I would request for other future things where you could possibly ask the photographer to do some details.
Right.
Some of the magic in these works has to do with very closely looking at certain parts of paintings on the jugs and the paintings.
Yeah.
And in the past, there have been woven pieces, whatever. Just a few close-ups would really help us. And
yes.
Thank you.
That's a well-taken technical point, to which I wouldn't seek to refute, other than to say that the purpose of the PowerPoints is simply to refresh, remind, or entice, and that the ekphrastic work of description falls on the panel.
Right.
It does, but then it becomes a lecture, not a panel. That's the only problem. But anyway,
that's
Dennis.
Right. That's
Dennis Carden. I just wrote a review of Mary Read Kelly for Art in America that's out this month, and I couldn't help but think about her piece the Thong of, of Dionysus, that used, it was all entirely in black and white for those of you who didn't see it, and it involved a lot of faux kind of urns that were decorated in similar ways and also had projections on them that were actually animated projections while the people were using it. To me, what was interesting about the two things in juxtaposition was that I thought the clays kind of were very aestheticized and very like deliberate and kind of, there was no like nothing offhand or casual to give them a sort of energy. And maybe that was the kind of Ozymandias reference, was the sort of, you know, just the seriousness of them that I kind of missed. Looking at them, I missed that energy that Mary Read Kelly had in those pieces.
Right. Mm. Fantastic. Thank you. And
this woman in red had her hand up.
A woman in red, one? Yes. We can't miss a woman in red. Let's Joel, if you would. Thank you. And by the way, a good moment to thank Joel Whitney, who does many more... Who does things in this institution that surpass handing around the mic, I can assure you.
I'm Grace Markman, and what I found interesting, in addition to the technical intrigue of the Bradford painting, was her reference to Florian Stettheimer. Oh. I really felt that connection. Mm-hmm. Not so much in the specifics, because Florian was extremely specific in her events and her details and her dates even.
Yeah.
But in the general sense of it all, of the human experience, the Bradford was a more generalized and a more, it had other things going on with the oceanic and the astral. But I still appreciate the reference to the Stettheimer.
Right.
Fantastic.
Okay, thank you very much. You know, I'm tempted to break my rule. There's a lot of good hands going up. Let's try the gentleman. I think it's Drew Lowenstein. My eyes are going, but right at the back there. These are all...
Right, you are.
Right.
I would agree with that Florian Stettheimer reference, and I think it must have been about 7 or 8 years ago that the Met brought their Florian Stettheimers out of storage, and I'm thinking that it was probably about that time that perhaps the sort of quirky, charming school of painting was pretty much played out. I'm wondering whether you share that opinion or not.
Well, we're not taking questions, we're only taking comments, but it's good to hear that you're thinking of it. Let me just say, though, that it's something very gratifying for me, and I'm always self-conscious of sounding like it's too clubby, but I don't mind it. I'm going to be clubby. I just like the fact that we have an audience of this size and magnitude and energy and putting up with the technical little difficulty at the beginning, staying in this hot room till the end. A big thank you to the audience. But I'd also like to say, in this audience, just as members of the audience, members of the public, you might think, we have people who've been on these panels in the past and will be on them in the future, and people who write for Art Critical magazine, and I'm just going to do that sort of thing that my rabbi used to embarrass us doing in the synagogue, and to say, Drew Lowenstein, who just asked that question, Barry Schwabsky, whose comment didn't unfortunately go anywhere with this panel. Jennifer Riley, who's said nothing but has been on a panel in the past. Dennis Carden, who's been on a panel in the past. Roman Kalinowski is one of our young writers at Art Critical. And I think I've heard other and seen other faces and heard other voices. But just to say, this is a... I just wanted to...
Do you want to offer good wishes to anyone whose relatives are ill?
Okay.
In that spirit, the calling out and acknowledging and thanking these individuals who are here in the audience is by way of atonement to continue the rabbinic of the fact that in a spectacular fail, I mean, if you thought the PowerPoint was lousy, Mr. Stanley Cohen, the card that we printed and gave out to you, and I was so proud to be able to get that card printed after deciding the show 3 days ago, Unfortunately, leaves out the names of the panelists. do keep the card as a souvenir of journalistic hubris or whatever. But and do write on it the names in nice big block capitals: Svetlana Alpers, Laurie Fendrick, and David Sally, who will be our guests on Tuesday, March the 8th, here at the Brooklyn Public Library to discuss shows of Karen Kalimnik, Cameron Rowland, Amy Silman, and Mika Tajima. And Brooklyn Public Library, great audience, fantastic panel. Thank you very much.